Good afternoon, everybody. It feels good to be back in the Bay, although I'm very worried about y'all. This is not normal weather, which means we need to be very concerned. I mean, even though I'm sure we're all going to enjoy it or are enjoying it, I think it speaks to one of the main things that we've been trying to get prepared for, because we see it coming in some different ways down in Jackson, which is climate change. And I know for me, I haven't recently had to, help to bring two little people into the world. I've been very concerned about what in the hell are we leaving them, and what can we do about it? We gotta do something about it quick. But, that said, good to see you all again. Some of y'all for the first time. I'm gonna try to be like fairly quick today, and not my normal like quick, which is like 30 minutes, but a real quick, to get into some dialogue and discussion about what are some of the things I think folks can learn from our experience, you know, that are applicable, I think, to this situation, meaning the Bay in general. But then also get into some conversation about how to move some things forward, how to strengthen some relationships that we need, you know, just straight up for our work in order to move forward. But then to talk about some challenges and also opportunities. I'm one who's kind of maybe contrary to a lot of other people. I'm really enjoying this period. I've really had a lot of fun the last year. I'm really enjoying Trump's presidency, quite honestly, because I think it's a clarifying issue. It's been very clarifying. Not that Trump is necessarily doing anything different than Obama or Bush before him, but at least the terms that he is applying in the operation of the empire, I think is at least making some distinctions clear between, you know, where we need to be acting and who we need to be aligned with, and a lot of the liberal illusions are just being cast aside. And that, I think, is a good thing. Like, I think that's a great thing, because now we can have, you know, some more serious conversations about what is the nature of the system, what do we need to be doing, you know, how to assess who's, you know, friend from foe, have some real conversations about, you know, where this is going, what compromises we're willing to make, what compromises shouldn't we make, you know, how do we build alliances, how do we build fronts, on whose terms, whose conditions. We're having different conversations, at least in my corner of the world, than we had most of my adult life. And to me, that's a good thing, because it's not conversations about pretension that I have allies that I don't really have, right? Or I'm expecting something favorable from the state, or I'm expecting some compromises from the state, or I'm expecting some, you know, capital to bend here or there in some particular ways, or leave a few crumbs here and there for us to pick up or to fight over or to scrap over. They're making it all pretty clear. We're not compromising, and we ain't giving you shit, right? So that, to me, I think is a good thing that we need to grasp and not be like moping around, well, we don't know what to do, or it's so hard, whatever the situation is. And this is one of the things I think living in Mississippi is giving you some clarity about, that I think many folks here in California, you know, and I'm from California originally, you know, for those of you who don't know, I grew up in Los Angeles and spent almost a decade living and working here. And I always felt, to be honest, and some of y'all remember me saying this, that in the difference between growing up in Los Angeles and growing up here, the Bay Area always felt like a liberal illusion. A liberal illusion. In the sense that, at least, you know, in part of the world that I grew up in LA, we didn't have like a sprawling nonprofit complex that you had here in the Bay, at least when I got here, right? That was profoundly different. between LA and here. Not so much now, in some respects, probably not that much then, actually, just the level of my exposure to it. But I would feel like there's so many people who at least proclaim to be somewhat on the left, doing all of this activist and social justice work, but we run nothing, we have no power. And that to me always felt like it was a liberal delusion, whereas in Los Angeles it was always very clear, these are the folks that's running stuff, they have the LAPD enforce their rules, and then there's us, right? Like, to me that was always very clear what the terms were and then what we needed to do from our side of the equation as to, you know, who are our friends, who are our enemies, what we need to be building. And I think that just having that clarity is always sobering. And to me, Mississippi is one of the most sobering places on the planet. Because, you know, it's very clear, and it's always been fairly clear, about, you know, if I step across the Pearl River, I'm very clear about where I am and how long I can be there, quite literally. You know, like, I don't like being on the other side of the Pearl River too long after dark. Whether I'm in a car, definitely not walking, right? And it's pretty clear. The safe side for me is over here on, you know, the east side, or the west side of the Pearl River, not the east side. Now, I'm not saying that that's a good thing, and I'm not saying it's necessarily a universal thing, but there's no pretension as to whether some folks on that side of the river see me actually as a human being. But they make it pretty clear most of the time, I do not. And if and when things turn, I will have you picking cotton or picking something else again. Like, that's very clear, very obvious. They don't hide it, they don't disguise it, they don't try to, you know, mask it over. It's very clear, it's in your face. They use some little watchwords, but for the most part, you know, it's very clear. And for folks who are looking at what we've been doing in Jackson and been wondering, like, well, how did they accomplish that? That clarity that exists within the community is actually what I would say did most of the work to accomplish that. You know, not that we didn't work hard, not that folks have not been putting in time, effort, and energy, you know, for decades, that's all true. But there's a generalized social consciousness that exists that we are just a small contributing element to. And I think our particular piece, you know, in the broader sense of the forces that have articulated in the Jackson-Kush plan, the thing that we've, I think, at best sometimes come with is little strategies, little plans, little tactics on how to fight back, how to collectively organize ourselves, how to wield power here, or how to move something there. Those are the things that you know, so-called conscious forces have brought to the table in the context of Jackson that have been able to move Cooperation Jackson to build and develop in the way that it has, or for us to have some success in the electoral arena, right? The critical thing is to understand what the ground already is that you're working with, and then how to move within that. And I've often felt in other places I've lived, not just here, we don't often have a clear assessment of the ground. Like, we imagine it to be something other than what it is. And then sometimes if we imagine it to be, in my experience, when we imagine it to be something that it is, we act upon that imagination, but it's not necessarily grounded in actual concrete material fact. And then we develop plans, hopefully, sometimes we do, to go out and try to move on that, to move people to power. But it's not based upon, you know, where the folks are actually at in their own perception of the world. Right? And Mississippi has taught me that one, like, very clear. I remember years ago, you know, going down there, you know, to help out some of the work. And, you know, we all been trained, we have our little organizing raps and what our talking points is about, you know, I'm trying to convince you, somebody, to do X, Y, and Z, or to join us in doing X, Y, and Z. And you'd be like, well, first let me try to convince you that there's a problem that you have. Right? And that'd be very quickly, the folks I would always run into, like, I know all the problems, that, like, you're not telling me something I don't know. The question is, what are we going to do about it? What can we do about it? And they always reframed it for me. And that was always an excellent point to me. It would be like, well, I want to construct this with you together. You know, like, you try to get into that kind of thing, which is not a bad thing. But it was always a deeper push around, well, if you're here talking to me, that must mean you got some idea about what we can do. So why don't you get to the idea about what we can do and let me see if I agree with it or not, right? And if I agree, I might show up. If I don't, it was a pleasure talking to you. And they'll tell you nicely, you know, in the Southern style, like, you know, thank you, young blood, or whatever, for, you know, young brother for talking to me, you know, and have a nice day. You know, God bless your heart or something like that. You know, they'll let you go. But, you know, it was always, in general, I think, a real conversation about, well, what is your idea about what we can do differently? And then that was one of the things that I know for me started to get me to think about some of the things that I've committed to writing around the Jackson-Kush plan. You know, with others, it wasn't just me, but with others about what can we really do? You know, what's our starting point? What can we move? What's within the realm of not possibility in terms of objective conditions, but what's in the realm of our ability to do as a small organization of however many people to actually move and then get other people to move. Like, that is the basis of that plan, and it became the basis of the organizing, and then you see some of the results. Now, the critical thing, I just, you know, to give folks a sober assessment about Jackson and what's happening there now. I think in 2013, we kind of caught some of the forces that be. They underestimated the general forces that were pushing forth their program, right? And that enabled, on the surface, if you want to look at it, that enabled Chokwe to get elected. You don't surprise people too often, especially those forces. You don't surprise them too often twice, right? So to the extent that we had made that, if you know, we made that move, they started making counter moves. Like, because they don't stand still, and oftentimes they learn a lot quicker than we do, right? And they have more resources to do it, we gotta be honest about that. But they learn a lot quicker than we do. And in those, you know, in that countervailing period of time, they've made some critical advances that we now all have to deal with, I think, to really keep this project and its overall scope moving. And I think this next period, meaning like the next year to 2 years, I think is going to be decisive as to whether the notion of power that's articulated in the Jackson-Kush plan can actually succeed or not. Because one of the clear things that the other side of the equation is moving on now is gentrifying Jackson. And it's a gentrification that is very vocal in its intent. The Chamber of Commerce put out a couple of documents which basically just straight up said, in order for us to change the city the way we want to change it, we need to reduce the black population within a period of, I think it said, was it 10 to 15 years? I have to get my memory straight on that. But they said they had to reduce it by 20% within that time period. And because in their analysis, it was the demographics and the conditions in Jackson, or in Mississippi in general, which enables, you know, someone with the history of a Chokwe Lumumba to get elected. And that if you could change the demographics, you then eliminate that, because they could introduce candidates that would then split the black vote, and they only needed to split it to a certain amount, and then they control the dynamic. I mean, it was a beautiful systemic. When I saw the paper and it got kind of handed to us, you know, kind of on the down low, when I read it, I was like, you know, I want them on my side of the equation for their level of analysis of how quick it came. And they're serious about moving it. They're very serious about moving it. And here's the rub. Part of the deal is, you know, for us as a whole, like progressive forces on the whole, if we aren't very clear about what our narrative of development is and what our plan for development is, we could and might actually be aiding in development of our own population's demise. In the name of bringing more jobs, in the name of developing Jackson, like we might actually all wind up playing a particular role of furthering their agenda in the pursuit of a very short-sighted economic agenda, which is not clear about how do you help enable development from within, right? What is our faith in the actual capacity of the people who live in the community to change their circumstances? And how do you do this without being reliant upon finance capital? Like, that's a deep question. And we ain't gonna lie to you until we've totally figured it out ourselves, right? There's a particular reason why I'm saying we in this context, because Brandon, he'll talk some more about it. You know, we have our own notions about where cooperatives fit into this whole narrative. And one of the things that we want to kind of dispel is that co-ops in and of themselves are an answer to that question. They're not. Let's be clear about that, right? And we all know that without any clear political direction, many co-ops can actually be and are instruments of gentrification themselves, right? So we need to be clear and honest about that. And so if we want to do something different in our case in Jackson, how do you build some entity which is involved, hopefully, in productive activities, which is not just about, you know, generating capital and then just distributing it differently, but can it really be an instrument about changing the relations of production in the society? That, that's the deeper question. And I would argue from our limited experience, if you don't, if your work in developing co-ops or a broader the solidarity economy, if it doesn't have a very clear political focus, if it doesn't have a very clear class articulated focus, and if it's not necessary, if it's not bridged by creating other solidarity projects that are based in production that are consciously and deliberately trying to upend the logic of capital, starting with, you know, changing the kind of your dependence upon the cash economy, and we can talk about what that all means later or at some other time. But if you're not intentionally doing that, then the best that you're doing is creating, you know, kind of small little operations where you and your friends, you know, can make things cheaper to a certain extent or make them sustainable for a certain period of time by doing at a serious level of self-exploitation. And I don't think you want to do that for long. I don't. And I'm trying to figure out how to get out of that particular dynamic. And so I think the critical piece, going back to the time period, is, you know, does the time and the challenges of the time enable us to think differently? I think it does. And if it enables us to think differently, can we act differently? I think that becomes then the challenge. That's the challenge we're trying to figure out in Jackson. We're not going to sit here and tell you we've totally figured it out. You know, we got all the standard issues that any other social movement organization or nonprofit, we got all that. You know, some people carry more of the burden than others. You know, some people not showing up to work on time. Some people are doing too much work. We got all that. We've made some little gains in the space of our context, but we're not above and beyond all those issues and contradictions. Now that said, I do think there's some things we're beginning to figure out. And how do we generalize those? We try to put some of that in the Jackson Rising book. But let me tell you one thing, and I hope you pick it up. You know, I guess I gotta be some self-pitch man for my own work. The book is about 2 years old, meaning like it came out 2 years late from when it was supposed to come out. Good thing for Comrade Ajamu. He really was a person at the end of the day that really forced us to get it out. One of the main pieces, just being honest, was that first chapter, the build and fight chapter. It took me about a year and a half to write that thing. And it was always like, oh, it's done. I'm gonna finish it next week. I'm gonna finish it next week, and I'd work on it, and I didn't like it. Or something about it didn't sit right with me, and I kept working on it, Then he's like, look, I'm gonna stop the project if you don't finish that damn essay. Like, I'm gonna quit. I'm the one who got to read and edit everything. I'm gonna stop. And to the very end, I'm actually still uncomfortable with that essay, with that particular piece of the book. Because I was trying to offer both a summation of our experience, but also a good snapshot of where we're trying to go and why. And I don't think it fully captured that. But I wind up having to be comfortable with is a moving target. And so I'm writing about things that I am myself constantly trying to understand, learn, process, and assess in relationship with my comrades and my own relationship with my own struggle with my own ideas. So I finally wind up being happy with that, and then we released the book. Now, of that said, if there's two essays in the book that I would encourage you to read, it would be that one, and the other one would be Casting Shadows, which is a later piece in the book, which gets into some of the concrete things that some of us were beginning to reflect upon about what we had succeeded in doing, what we were challenged in doing, and what we thought the road ahead should be, right? And we're still very fundamentally in that place. I still think, you know, despite some of the recent challenges some of you all may have heard, I still think we're in a damn good place in Jackson. And why do I say that? I at least am engaged, or we are at least engaged in a conversation about which direction something is going to go that actually has a material impact on thousands of people. And not just our own little bitty clique, right? And so it's very critical that, you know, being mindful of the weight that brings, that if we make some wrong decisions, it's going to impact a couple of thousand people, not just us. But also, you know, be comfortable with welcoming that responsibility. And that's the part I want to end on, because I think too often nowadays, with how a lot of the movement stuff has become framed in very narrow, individualistic terms, we are not comforted, and sometimes it always seems like we are running away from taking on the challenge of being responsible for each other and all that entails. And how ugly, nasty, dirty that may feel sometimes. But if I think we're serious about the project of liberation, we're gonna have to get back to that. And find ways of both articulating, building the organizations that are gonna be necessary to get us there. And I am one who's still going to argue that we need organizations to get us there. We need political forces, mass forces, and party forces to get us there. And we can debate that. Doing it individually, I don't think is going to get us anywhere other than helping, you know, foster and deepen neoliberal logic, which I don't think we want to do. But we got to find some ways to get out of that collectively. I think we can do that. I think we have to do that. And I think that's our challenge of how do we assume responsibility for change. And that's ugly. I think too many of us assume that means that we all have to be somehow morally perfect and pure then to execute that. That is not what I'm saying in the least, because if that was the criteria of struggle, then we all gonna fail. Like straight up. I know I'm not gonna pass. I wouldn't pass that test. But if that is our ultimate criteria of struggle, we all gonna fail. Because somebody you done crossed or did wrong or said something wrong, or they got a particular view or narrative about it, you know, that either we will continue to allow us to not engage each other, or we're just kind of, you know, devolving into doing our own things, right? And that's something I think we need to get out of it. And then the last thing, I skipped over and was trying to come back. So y'all see, I'm thinking, so I'm trying to cram a lot of stuff in real quick. But the main, you know, kind of essence that I think I just want to leave. We need to be doing a lot of experimentation during this time period. Like serious experimentation. We need to take a lot of chances. We need to take a lot of risks. Like I fundamentally believe that. Because I think folks are far more open to change right now than we've often presumed them to be. And I think we've seen the evidence of that the past couple of years. You know, not always in the best way, but I think we've seen it. And, you know, some of the things I remember, you know, most of my life growing up, there'd never be a black man that was president. Check that off. That didn't do us no good, but check it off. And then it was, you know, we're never going to have a serious conversation about socialism in this country. Now, I don't think, Bernie ain't talking about the same socialism I'm talking about. But he raised the question, and people responded in mass. And either, you know, we allow somebody else to define that, or we define it, right? But if we're not out engaging and raising that banner and pushing for it, then we're going to lose that ground and others are going to gain that ground. I don't think in this past year, despite how much I've liked it, I still haven't seen us as an organized body, you know, the AKA the so-called left in this country. We haven't acted that way, let's be honest. We haven't been out there really pushing our ideas, pushing our narratives, challenging, you know, the society, challenging the system. We haven't been doing that. And I want to encourage us, at the beginning of 2018, to step up to the plate and do the best we can.